So could you start off by stating your name?
My name is Edward E. Poindexter, Jr.
And what years did you attend Lyndon McKinley High School, and how old were you in 1971, and what grade were you in?
My first year at Lyndon McKinley was 1969, and I graduated in 1972. So in 1971, during this time frame, I was transitioning between 16 and 17 years old.
Mm-hmm. And what grade were you?
I was a junior.
A junior. Okay, mm-hmm. Great. So, you know, as we talked about before, you were actually the catalyst for this whole project.
Right.
This really came from you. And I wondered if you could describe for us a little bit who you were in 1971. What was going on with you? What were you doing?
Well, 1971, that was my junior year in high school. So at that point, I became a little more acclimated to the whole high school feel and experience. I was handling the year pretty well. I was an athlete, so I spent a lot of time in the athletic realm, if you would. I played football, as well as for the school I played football, but then I was also involved in sports outside of Lyndon McKinley and kind of type of intramural type programs. As far as the school year was concerned, it started out pretty much like every other school year, just getting familiar with classes and classmates and teachers. And it kind of rolled along like that for that whole year until the spring. Things started to change the late winter and early spring. The atmosphere started to change at that time.
Okay. Alan?
Yes. Mr. Poindexter, it looks like Celia had a bit of a technical issue.
Okay.
Lost her for a second. Oh, so I'm sure she's going to join us right back.
Okay.
So if you don't mind, I'm going to keep you engaged for a second.
Okay.
I'm sure she'll...
Great.
So we're talking about... So I'm looking forward to talking with you even more after this. I've got some questions, but I'll wait till this part of the project is done. I have more questions about the story, so she'll be really interested.
So will that be in this format, or will we be in a different format?
But nothing for right now. This is what's really critical.
Okay.
So I talked to Simone. She's out on a bike ride today, which would be nice.
Yeah, good. Good for her, yeah.
I think she's going to try to join us if she can.
Oh, okay.
I think it's vacation and anniversary season for her. Mine is coming up. So.
Is that right? Okay.
Yes.
How many years?
Oh, man, 24.
Okay. All right, great. Yeah. Great, yeah.
How about you?
Pardon me?
I said, how about you?
We just passed 43.
Trying to catch you, man. That's not bad.
It's just like walking, man. One foot in front of the other. You can't rush it, you know?
That's true.
Yeah.
Hey, let me see what's going on. Oh, she says, rejoining now. Laptop wasn't plugged in. It died. Give me a second.
Oh, wow.
No problem. We got it covered.
Okay.
So yeah, I guess what I'm really curious about a lot of things. I want to keep the focus on today's interview, but
okay.
I'm really interested in, you know, what it was like for you becoming a part of the protest, what really inspired you to participate, what inspired others, and things like you talked about this. You talked about how others were the leaders, and like you were a younger guy kind of coming in.
Yeah.
The way I remember you describing it.
Correct.
And I wonder what impact that had.
Uh-huh. Okay. Okay, welcome back.
Thank you. So, Alan, I just wanted to ask you, is my audio being recorded with Eddie's or no?
Yes, so in the Zoom call, everything's being recorded edit it out. That was the idea.
So that's what I wanted to know, on the channel that's being recorded in the room, if the mic in there is hearing me also.
I'm pretty sure it is. It's a pretty sensitive mic, but the plan was always to edit your audio out.
Right. Okay. So I just want to be sure.
The audio, is this picking you up in the background as a thing?
Yeah, because I don't want to interrupt him.
We anticipated that, so we'll have to work on it.
So Eddie, can you, getting back to Lyndon, and I'm going to go back a little bit before the spring, can you tell us what was the Lyndon community like in 71, and what was the vibe at the school? Was there racial tension there?
Well, the community and the school were really kind of one and the same as far as the relationships and the environment. In 70 and 71, there was the transition of what's known as white flight. From the mid-60s up to that point, that had been the case, where there was white flight because there was an influx of blacks coming from the east side of Columbus to the north end, what was called the north end of Columbus, and kind of settling in that area. So there was a lot of camaraderie between those that were coming from the east side to the north side. A lot of people knew one another relating to the relationship prior to coming to that community, to the Lyndon community. So there was some relationship already developed there, and name brands, as far as family names were concerned, came with that move. So there was a connection there as a result of that. But then there was also the connection of the whole community coming together as the black community to move the community forward and to keep us connected. So there were a lot of, there weren't a lot, but there was one particular effort being made in sports by one of the programs called the Lyndon Eagles football program. And that kind of was the catalyst, if you will, of the togetherness of the community. It was a little league football team and sponsored by fathers and relatives of the athletes, and so it brought the community closer together, because the younger generation, the 8 through 12 year olds, now had a place where they could come together and build relationship, where they could learn, and it was a learning process as well as an athletic endeavor. There was a lot of communication about morals. A lot of communication about respect and manners. And then there was a great deal of conversation about being a good teammate and a good sport. So sportsmanship was taught a lot. And it just kind of, it allowed the young community, the children, to be received better in the schools by the predominantly white staff and the other students, the white students that were there, because there was a standard that those that were involved in that particular program took with them into the school. So you could kind of know who was involved in that program, the Lyndon Eagle program. Especially when we went to what was then called the junior high schools, where we had influx from other areas of the city, the surrounding areas, where the junior high was fed into by other elementary schools. And some of those schools, the students that came in weren't a part of the Lyndon Eagle program. And there was a noticeable difference there.
Gotcha. So with this cohesion that was there in the black community, and then we have this shift of demographics where there are more black families moving to Lyndon, and that was reflected in the school, Can you talk about how that affected the atmosphere, the vibe in the school and in the community as well with regard to whites? So was there tension there? Was there anything that you picked up on in school? I know you mentioned something about, I remember you said prejudice was the status quo due to shifting demographics. And I thought that was a really interesting way to put it. Can you speak to that a little bit and how that affected the teacher's relationship with students?
Yeah, I think that was that tension was there because there were some teachers, as you went into the school, there were some teachers that had the prejudice, the preconceived ideas of what the students were going to be like. So they interacted with them with that anticipation, which led to some problems. But then you had other teachers that were more receptive and that were willing to help in the advancement of relationships between the students and the teaching staff, which was
the black students,
the teaching staff, the predominantly white teaching staff, as well as with the the existing white students that were there. But there was the tension that was common in the community at large and the country at large was part of it. Was there, it was inevitable that was going to be a part of what we were going to be dealing with. So yeah, that from that standpoint, that tension was still there. And as I think as the years went on from elementary to junior high to high school, there was a lessening of it, but nevertheless, it was still there at the school as well as in the community. Because the community was still predominantly white, so there were businesses and there were every place that you went, there were schools and there were libraries and everything was, when we went there, was still had that primary feel of it being a white community, and a white community that wasn't necessarily receptive to this transition that was taking place. So that tension was there.
So I'm going to move a little bit further into the year to February of 1971. And can you describe for us what happened at the Black History Week performance at Linda McKinley High School in February of 71? I guess part of that question, because I want to interrupt you as little as possible.
Okay.
Did you know the people who threw the flyers and how did this incident change things at school? So if you could just take us through it.
Okay. Well, as far as the play was concerned, it was kind of a build up to it, because it was Black History Month at that particular time. And, there was the conversation going around the school that there's going to be a play and the play is going to be exciting and the play is going to be really making a statement of, the blackness of who we were at that time as a black community and now a black, becoming a more of a predominant black school. And also in there make some statements about some demands that were wanted at the school, such as respect and such as more opportunities for black history education. So that buildup was there, and it was kind of an exciting time looking forward to that, trying to see what it really was going to be. And then leading up to that, it was known that it was going to happen, so it was just a normal assembly type atmosphere. The whole school was called into the auditorium. And the auditorium was big enough to take all of the students in at one time. So we were there, and there's a two level. There's a bottom floor, then there was a balcony. For me, I was located on the bottom floor, on the main floor, and the play was going along. And I think we were probably 2/3 into the play. It was a very everybody was spellbound, really, on what was being presented, and really enjoying it. And also just seeing some of our fellow students up there. Some were good actors and some weren't. So, you know, being the students that we were, you know, we were making fun of some of that. But it was just a good time. It was a good experience. And the atmosphere was although there were messages that were being presented, it wasn't tension in the auditorium. So, like I say, about two-thirds through, there's some rumbling taking place on the balcony area. Doors, you can hear doors opening, and then papers came flying over the balcony to the main floor. And, you know, so because of we weren't really paying attention to what was going on behind us, the balcony sat over some of the main floor, and then there was the opening part in front of the balcony. So I was kind of in that lower part, in that back part, so I couldn't really see what was going on, but I saw the flyers come over, but didn't really pay that much attention to what it was all about. But once the flyers were thrown over, then there was rumbling that you heard on the balcony area with doors slamming up, with doors flying open and people running. Well, at that point, someone looked at the flyers, saw what was on the flyers, the derogatory messages that were on the flyers, then saw the people running out upstairs, and then there were some people that gave chase to those who threw the flyers. They ran out of the building, had a car waiting for them to escape and get away, so there was never any confrontation between those people and the students. And at that point, the auditorium was just mayhem. There was just total. Unfortunately, there was some attacks that were made against the white kids that were in there, and then there was just some fussing and pushing and shoving. And after that, the teacher that was over the play. Came up on the stage once he figured out what was going on and saw the aftermath of it. He came up on the platform and got on the mic and just kind of calmed the whole crowd down, the whole student body down at that point.
And who was that teacher?
That teacher was Gary Davis.
In terms of the flyers themselves, what was on those flyers?
I wish I could tell you what was on there, but that was so long ago. I don't really know what was on the flyers. And
was it racist?
Oh yes. Now it was definitely a racist and derogatory message on the flyers. I just don't know what was on there.
Gotcha. And the person, at least one of the persons who was responsible for throwing the flyers over, was someone that you knew.
I didn't know them personally. No.
Okay. And did this incident, did it change things at the school?
Considerably. Yes.
Mm.
Yes.
It
changed things considerably.
How so?
Well, I guess a couple of different ways. One way was, There was really an outbreak of violence that started to occur between the black students and the white students, and there was a lot of unprovoked confrontations, altercations between the blacks and the white, and because there was the predominantly angry person were the black people, I was involved in some of that, so we relieved our hurt, our pain, our dissatisfaction with what was going on white students, and so quite naturally white students became fearful, and we had a large number of white students that left the school at that time and enrolled in other schools.
Let me ask you this. did the school, after this incident, did the administration ever address it? Did they, was there ever any consequences for any of the student, the white students who threw the flyers? Did the administration address this, you know, this, it was a kind of assault. Like, did they ever address that with the black students?
Well, you know, it was always that thing, I guess, over the morning announcements to try, you know, to try to calm the atmosphere and, you know, had some conversations about, you know, respecting one another, treating people the way that you want to be treated, understanding that we're all a student body of Lyndon McKinley and, you know, there's Lyndon Pride. So we should conduct ourselves that way. We don't want the community at large to have a negative kind of image of the school. So there were those kind of conversations that came from the administration. There may have been an assembly or two afterwards to bring people together and the principal kind of, you know, addressing not necessarily any action that was taken against that person, but just the event in and of itself.
Do you recall there ever being just a statement basically saying that was wrong?
Yes. Those were the kind of conversations that the administration, when we had our times of coming together and having an assembly and talking about the, you know, the, about what took place, that, you know, those were the kind of things that they wanted to try to get across to move from that to a better place.
Gotcha. And in these, you know, in terms of the conflict that happened amongst students after this event, were there ever any instances where white students were doing, not necessarily attacking, but where white students were the catalyst for these unprovoked attacks? I mean, you know, was there anything that was ever initiated by white students? Because I'm wondering that because I'm thinking about the fact that they at that point, this sort of majority, you know, and then that sort of shifting, and also just the youth, and it sounded like emotions were high.
I don't recall hearing anything like that. I think what their response was to congregate together, always have numbers to try to prevent, you know, being singled out or being outnumbered. So there was kind of the separation, you know, they kind of stayed in their area of the school where there was that lunchtime or prior to coming into the school in the morning, and then exiting as soon as possible together once school was over. So I think it was more that I never heard of any retaliation as far as white groups retaliating against anybody black.
I see. Okay, so let's move a little bit further and talk about there was a demonstration in March of 1971 at the Board of Education, and that was something that was attended by parents and students, and you were there. And so I wondered if you could talk a little bit about what that was like. You know, there was a demonstration at a meeting at the Board of Education building, and so if you could talk about what that was like and what you saw.
Okay, well, it took place in the morning, which meant that I snuck away from school to go and be a part of it because it was not sanctioned by the school to be a part of that. So, but there were, you know, there were numerous of students who did the exact same thing. And so we heard that there was going to be a conversation between parents and some community leaders in regards to what happened at the school and to discuss some ways to make things better for the school and for the community at large. So it was, the way it was set up was There were speakers inside, those people, parents and community leaders. Outside were predominantly students, but there were also some parents and some community people outside as well. So it was somewhat organized because we were supposed to march around. It's just a block wide, march around the block, just kind of as a sign that we were protesting, and people had signs. And then there was a large gathering also of people in the parking lot that weren't marching. So,
can I interrupt you one second? Mm-hmm. I just want to clarify that the parents and community leaders and students, these were black people who were addressing the issues that were concerning them?
I don't know exactly who they were and if they were all black or not, but I do know that the majority of the parents were that I knew of were black, and one of the community leaders that I knew that was really involved in the community, the Linden community at large, was there, and he was black. So once again, I don't know who all was inside because I wasn't able to go inside.
I'm in outside. But oh, you saw around too.
So outside, who were the people outside? Yeah, they were all black. There weren't any, there wasn't any white participation in that, other than the security for the school board. Okay.
So go ahead. I'm sorry.
So I just recall us marching around just twice, and that was pretty much it. Then it was just congregating in the parking lot and around the front part of it until it was over. And then that was it. We were dispersed, and I went back to school.
And while you were outside, when the spokespeople were inside and you were outside, what was the atmosphere like? Was it orderly? And, who was kind of managing the situation?
It was definitely orderly. There were some students that were kind of communicating to stay on the sidewalk, don't get in the street. But there were also adults that were doing that as well. But primarily, it was a peaceful protest and march around the school board. There wasn't any problems at all.
So a couple months after that, on May 19th, there was a march from Linda McKinley High School to Franklin Park to a rally that was happening in Franklin Park that was to commemorate Malcolm X's birthday.
Mm-hmm.
And you took part in that as well. So can you describe that experience for us and give us a sense of what Franklin Park was like at that time?
Well, it was one of those things that, once again, by word of mouth, that this is what we're going to do. We're going to march from the school to Franklin Park in celebration of the birthday of Malcolm X. And so it started at the school in the afternoon, after lunch. Anybody that was going to go would meet at the school and then march from our school to Franklin Park, which was probably 6 or 7 miles, or maybe a little bit further. It was a long march, but it was primarily down one street, Cleveland Avenue, to Broad Street to the park. So it was kind of a not much of a variation on where we were going to be marching. And once again, it was orderly. It was a orderly march with students and adults and teachers monitoring to make sure that everyone stayed on the sidewalk. And we were also kind of escorted by the police department because their cars were in that lane next to the sidewalks. So they were kind of acting as a buffer, but also making sure that there wasn't any problems that were going to break out. So then we went down to the park, and there was some speakers and music, and it was more of a time of socializing. It wasn't a tensed time. It wasn't a violent time or an angry time. It was a time really for celebration, which we were down there to do, which was to celebrate the birthday of Malcolm X. Franklin Park had a history in Columbus at that time as the local gathering place for the black community throughout the whole city. It was a gathering place normally on holidays such as the 4th of July, Memorial Day, and things of that nature. And it was a big, big family park. The 4th of July, there would be fireworks and firecrackers and a lot of barbecuing going on. So the park itself was set up at that time where there was a road that went around the park, and then there were several entrances into that road. Well, generally on Saturday and some on Sunday, but Saturday around 1 or 2 o'clock was showcase time. And that was the time where the young adults and some adults who spent the whole morning waxing and washing and cleaning up their cars would come through and showcase their rides. So the speed limit at that time was probably 3 miles an hour to make sure that everyone could see their cars. It was lined car after car after car after car. They would, you know, have music playing. It was just, it was a fun time. And it was a time for recognition if you had a car. So that was kind of the gathering place, Franklin Park, at that time. And just a lot of good memories, a lot of happy thoughts about that whole park opportunities. And it was a fun time.
I'm sorry I missed it.
You would have enjoyed it, yeah.
I'm sure. So later that month, on the 24th of May, there was a meeting at Bethel AME Church. And I don't know if you wanted to talk about that, or if not, if you're, you know, feeling sort of sketchy on that, we can move ahead to the flag itself.
We'll move to the flag. It's really another one of those situations where I just showed up. I wasn't involved. I wasn't a part of anything. You know, I couldn't tell you who all was in the church. I was one of the parking lot people hanging out in the parking lot, until it was over. Although, you know, there had been conversation about at the end of that there was going to be a walk or a march over to the school and put the flag up, the red, black, and green flag. So I knew that was going to take place. So that was kind of the draw that drew so many students and people that were part of the community. Because on these things that took place, whether it was at the church or whether it was at the school board, it wasn't just the students that were involved in those. There were people from the community. People from other schools were involved in that. Some former alumni were a part of that, the things that were going on there. So this is what was going on that night. It was a lot of people there that weren't necessarily students. So then, you know, the word was out that, when that's over, we're going to go over to the school and we're going to raise the flag, the Black National flag, and that will be the climax of that night. Did happen.
So can you take us from maybe being in the parking lot at the end of the meeting to, you know, and then going over to the school? Would that work?
Yeah. At the end of it, you know, there's only a block and a half from the church to the school. So it was a straight shot from the parking lot down the alley to the school, which is Duxbury, which is two parks away, and then down a block and there's the school. So people were, it wasn't a march, you know, people were just going in any direction they wanted to get to the school, because there's different ways you could go. But everyone eventually ended up either on the front lawn of the school, the sidewalk of the school, or on the other side of the street of the school. So that's kind of the way it worked. And everybody just walked over there and were just waiting to see, was it really going to happen, first of all? Because the school was closed, and we're trying to figure out, well, how are they even going to get up to the flagpole, which is on top of the school, and put the flag up there? And so out of the night, someone shines a light up at the flagpole, and a friend of mine, Donald Vassar, is up there, and he puts the flag up, hoists the flag up. And so when he did that, everybody just broke out into clapping and cheering and just a bunch of high-fiving, and all of that was going on as a result of seeing the flag up there.
And can you describe, what flag did he put up there?
He put the red, black, and green flag, national flag that we called it, the black national flag.
And when you were standing there, can you describe what was going through your mind, how you felt seeing that red, black, and green flag flying?
You know, there was a sense of pride, you know, that one, the flag was there. And then just that it had been done, you know, so there was a good feeling about that. You know, that was kind of it, because we knew once that was done, things weren't going to last very long before the police were going to show up. Okay, so it was kind of a momentary excitement about what had taken place. But then it was also, okay, we need to get out of here now, because we know the police are going to show up.
And can you tell me around how many, you said before that you were with your crew of friends, with some other athletes, right? But how many students were out there overall, or how many people were out there overall when the flag went up?
From what I can recall, I would say there's probably about 300 people out there. There were quite a few on the lawn, which is right in front of the school. But then I was on the other side of the street, which is just, you know, sidewalks and homes right behind that. So that's where I was at. And there weren't as many people there, but I could see, you know, quite a few people that were in the grass area. So I was, that's just a guess.
Wow. That's quite a visual.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's quite a visual. So then the next day at school, there was an assembly, and it was an unauthorized assembly that was called. And again, if you don't want to get into the details of that, we can talk about, because I do, you know, I definitely understand how memory works, and how, you know, I'm sure the part that we talked about when you were in that second floor classroom is probably what stands out the most, because it's the most you know, it was what it was. So if you want to start with that, if you want to start with kind of how you got into that second floor classroom, or why you were in that second floor classroom.
Okay. All right. Well, it would start with the unauthorized assembly, because, you know, when the word was out that we're going to meet in the auditorium, it wasn't an official meeting called by the administration. But because it was called by our fellow leaders, black leaders, then, you know, it was just like automatic. Everybody's just going to go. So. You know, well, the black leaders that I knew that were the voice of some of the demands and some of the conversation between the administration would be John Wells, John Harrington, not John, I'm sorry, John Wells, John Whitaker, Donald Vassar, and those were the primary ones that I knew of that were kind of the face of those that were having this conversation. So the word just kind of spread around that, and John Wells was the primary spokesperson that was really pulling things together and making issues known, who was a friend of mine, a really good friend of mine, one of my fellow football players. So you know, I knew that he, when he said something, I listened to it. So it was called. I was on the balcony at this time, and so then we were told by the administration that we had to get out of the auditorium. And at that time, everyone was leaving out of the auditorium. And in the process of leaving out, unbeknownst to us, someone in advance had called the police department and said that there was going to be trouble at the school. So we're leaving out of the auditorium, and all of a sudden, on the lower level, you could hear all kind of ruckus going on, doors flying open, loud voices, and then the teachers that were in the rooms up on that second level came out of their rooms and started telling everybody that was coming out of the auditorium to come into the classrooms because the police was coming. And so they wanted everybody out of the hallway, so it was just come into whatever room was open and go in there. So I went into the first one that was there, looked out the window, and sure enough, the street is lined with police cars, and police are now coming up to the school on the sidewalk, coming up on the grass, coming into the school. Billy clubs out, pulling their gloves, their black gloves up, coming in, really to cause hurt. So then, as they're coming up, now students are starting to run out of the school onto the front lawn and really just trying to get out of the school because the police are coming in. And the police that are out there are now just wanting to you know, arrest these students. So, you know, they're hitting the students with the billy clubs. They're hitting them with their fists. And then there are some students that are fighting back. So now there are fights that are going on between the police and the students. And it was just mayhem. It was a scary sight to see.
Were the police, were they dealing with, were they hitting and being physical with boys and girls?
Yes, they were physical with everybody. They were physical with boys. They were physical with girls. They were fighting teachers, they were fighting janitors, they were really fighting anyone that was resistant or anyone that was unwilling to adhere to what they were saying.
So let me ask you this. How did you feel? Can you describe how you felt when you were still in the classroom and you looked out and saw all of these the lines of police cars and the police coming, you know, with their billy clubs and putting on their gloves? How did you feel at that point?
Fear, you know, just absolute fear, you know, not knowing what was going to happen. And just that whole image of seeing literally so many police cars that they lined almost from the almost a block of police cars, and then the amount of police that were there. Some were in police uniforms, some were in undercover attire, and just to see that was just, it was unbelievable, really, is what it was. You know, I couldn't believe what I was seeing was happening. And so, you know, so that was the emotion that came up. I was, it was really a fearful situation.
And what about, when the melee was actually happening? So when you were seeing police hit your peers, your friends, the other kids that you knew, and did you, were you hit?
No, I wasn't hit. No, I was in the classroom. I stayed in the classroom. Oh. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. And when did you, at what point did you leave?
At the point where school was dismissed, which was...
And how long after was that?
I would say, I couldn't really pinpoint it, a few hours afterwards.
Okay. And to your knowledge, did the school offer any support services after that incident?
No, definitely not. No, that was not, no, that wasn't even a consideration, I don't think.
Okay. Now, that was at the end of March, or toward the end of, I mean of May, sorry. So what was the rest of the school year like? And can you talk about the school being shut down?
After that, the school was shut down, literally. Classes were discontinued. There wasn't any activity, extracurricular activities of any type taking place at that point. And that was it. You know, school was officially shut down. And there wasn't anything that took place until we did receive, you know, information, written information, that there would be a time to come back to school just to take your final exams, and then you were assigned designated days and times for you to come and take your exam, and then there was another designated time for you to come and pick up your report card after that.
Okay, now I'm going to backtrack just a little bit to the police raid. Do you remember, do you recall any specific people were in conflict with the police, or the police were attacking, or were getting into it with the police?
So Mr. Poindexter, what I was imagining is if you could just see yourself back in that moment as you're standing across the street looking at that lawn, I know just what you're describing, and as you scanned across the lawn with your eyes and you saw the police, as you described, you know, having physical altercations with students, with teachers, and with staff. Are there any particular, I remember this specific teacher or that janitor or this student, and describe a little bit of what happened, please.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Was there anybody in particular that you recall?
There was, the worst I saw was a police officer hitting one of the female students with their billy club, hitting her in the stomach, and making her fall to the ground, and then arresting her. I think that was the worst thing that I saw take place.
Did you know her?
Yeah, I knew her. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And can you talk about her a little bit? Who was she? And did you have a chance to talk to her afterwards?
I didn't talk to her afterwards. I don't know if I should give her name or not, but she was someone that I knew, not as a close friend, but someone that we were well enough to be associates with one another, and just somebody that I never would have thought would be in a situation like that, because she was extremely nice, and I you know, from the relationship that I had with her, I thought she was a pretty compliant person, but I don't know. But regardless of what her personality was, I don't think it warranted her getting beaten like that by the police and then arrested. So that one stays in my mind. That, you know, that was on the front lawn. And it was, I don't know, it was like I couldn't see anything else going on around while that was going on. So that was the worst thing.
And did you talk to her after that?
No. After that, school was closed. You know, so, and she was a senior. So when school came back in, school didn't resume until the following year. So I didn't see her anymore after that. I don't know if I really even have had a chance to talk to her since high school.
Okay. So I want to ask you about, you mentioned John Wells being a friend of yours, and I wondered if you could talk about some of the other students and, you know, your relationship or friendship with them. Some of the others who were activists, who were these voices of activism and who had these concerns that they were bringing to the fore. So I'm thinking John Whitaker, Valora Washington, Al Young, Donald Vassar, Zola Diggs, and Zola is your cousin?
Now, Zola's my cousin, I didn't really know that Zola was that involved in the inner circle of the students that were bringing these concerns and these petitions to the administration. So once again, I wasn't even aware until we started this project that she was even involved in it. But as far as the ones that I can say that I really knew are primarily people that I knew relating to sports, relating to football, relating to the Linden Eagles program. That would be Donald Vassar, Al Young, and John Wells. Now, John Whitaker, I didn't really know John. John was a senior at that time, so I didn't really know him, but he was the most articulate of what I thought anyway. I held him in that regard. He was the most articulate of the inner circle and seemed to be the one that was trying to move things ahead without there being an aggression involved in it. So Donald Vassar was, I think he was more of, I saw him more of the tough guy. You know, he was kind of like the self-proclaimed, I guess, sergeant of arms of that group that kept things in line and kept the rabble-rousers out that they didn't really want to be a part of it. That's kind of the role that he played. He and I were good friends from football, very good friends. And then there was John Wells. And John, I knew John since I was, well, and Don as well, since I was 12. And John and I played football together for 2 or 3 years and just developed a real good friendship with one another. But it wasn't the type of friendship where we really hung out together. It was more of a friendship where we were knitted together as lifelong friends because of our relationship we built playing football together. So that was our relationship. I knew that John was into the black activism. I probably about 2 years after we played football, I saw him moving in that direction. So I wasn't surprised that he would have that type of a role in this core group of people. He was the most militant of that core group. And I knew him from that perspective before he was a part of that.
Gotcha.
And just a really, really good friend. And then Al Young, the other, I didn't know that Al was that involved in it, in this inner circle as well. But Al and I, we go back a long way as well from athletics.
And were you aware that this group, and I know that the group, you know, probably shifted a little bit over time, but were you aware that they were meeting outside of school to sort of talk about politics and talk about social issues and ideas?
I had no idea. Zero. No idea. Because keeping in mind that they were seniors and I was a junior. So, you know, there really was that whole underclass thing, you know, like, okay, we're the seniors, you guys are the juniors, so you're the sophomores. So there really was some of that going on as far as school was related, in school. You know, outside of school, that didn't exist. But in school, that existed, where that group that I mentioned, excluding Zola, were all seniors. So when they were doing their meetings and their collaborations, that's who was in that group.
And can you talk a little bit about how school, how Linda McKinley changed from 71, from that school year to the next school year?
Okay. Mm-hmm. So 1972... started out pretty much just like 1971, but there was a little more friction in the air. I don't think that there was the same volatility that there was as the school year ended, as far as relationships between the black and the white students. I think it kind of went back to the way things were to a degree. My sophomore year when I went there, it seemed like there was just more of a togetherness then. So that kind of did start to occur that next year, my senior year. A lot of the students that were there, white students and black students, went to school together, some from all the way from junior high and up into now our senior year. So for a lot of us, there was still that friendship. There was still a friendship there although it was on edge, but yet there was still that camaraderie. Now, I I'm also looking at it from the athletic standpoint, from the football team, because we had, we had blacks and white playing on our football team. So it's kind of different when you're an athlete and you're on a team. You want to have that togetherness, that camaraderie. So you're maybe more willing to set some things aside so that you can be successful as a team. So I think that's what happened with athletics as a whole throughout the whole school, because Linda McKinley was known as a high-performing athletic school. So we sought to be the best in the city in every sport. So I think that's kind of what allowed there to be a coming back together my senior year.
And were there fewer white students?
It's interesting because I didn't think that there were a lot, but just in working together on this project, I did some looking back at the yearbook, and there were a lot more there than I thought there were. So yeah, but it was still a predominantly, I would say probably 70-30, 70% black, 30% white.
And did you have, you mentioned something about having an influx of black teachers. Can you talk about that?
That took place that year as well. We had an influx of black teachers from some of the HBCU colleges that came in. Prior to that, the only two that we had that were relatively young were Gary Davis and Bruce Bunch, who were our black studies teachers, our black history teachers. And we had a few more, but they were probably the youngest. Well, now we had this big influx of younger black teachers that came in. And that I think, kind of calmed things down as well, as far as the tension that was there between the students and the white teachers. So that was part of the calming also of that of our senior year. And that year was from a senior's standpoint, I thought it was a good year. It was a it was a happy year. I was happy about that year. I think most of the people that were there kind of felt that way as well. From a white student standpoint, I think there was still that edge there, you know, kind of walking on eggshells.
Can I ask you, why did this story stick with you for so long? The incidents that happened in 1971, why did that stay with you this whole time?
I think it stayed with me, you know, for a couple of reasons. It stayed with me because it was something that took place in that whole era of black power, that whole era of becoming black and proud and being willing to see life from a different perspective as a young black male. And I think that had something to do with it. The other thing is, I think that seeing something like that at a young age take place with the police department, because, you know, at that time you saw stuff on TV that was taking place in Cleveland and Philadelphia and, you know, things that were taking place down south in Alabama. But to see it right in front of your eyes at your school was just, I think that's the reason why it had such an impact as a point in my life that I will never, ever forget because of how traumatic it was. So I think that's how it came about now.
And then I'd like to ask you your thoughts on the demonstrations that have been happening this year. I mean, this year has been it's been something else. I mean, there's been a lot going on, and in the midst of the pandemic, you know, we had demonstrations against police brutality and for Black Lives Matter in the wake of police killing of George Floyd, and we have this incident that happened with Breonna Taylor and so many others that have happened previous to this year. And things sort of evolved in such a way that I don't think anyone expected. And so I wondered if you could talk about your feelings, you know, whatever those feelings are. I'm not looking for a specific answer, but I'm wondering, for someone who experienced what you experienced in 1971, then how does it strike you now?
Well, I think it's like, it's almost polar. Like, there's this over here and over here. Because in the 60s, there was a lot going on as well, as far as police brutality, as far as racism, as far as, segregation. And in the 60s, I grew up more of a Martin Luther King leader perspective on how to influence change, which was nonviolently. And, you know, of course, you know, it wasn't totally there because there was the Malcolm X and the Black Panthers and all of that. But that wasn't my perspective on how I would want to be a part of getting things done. And I think that's what I see today. I see that there's a way to do things that are being done now that are differently than what my imprint, if you will, on how to handle effectively changing things. I grew up where there was a lot of police brutality. Columbus was known as a place where there was police brutality taking place. And there were several incidents. One was called the Kahiki incident that took place here in Columbus, where the owner called the police on some patrons there that were patronizing this restaurant, and the police came in and beat them up on site, took them downtown and beat them while they were in the paddy wagon, and then roughed them up when they got them down at the police department. Well, that caused a lot of outcry here in Columbus, but it never turned to the place where it became violent. So when I see what's taking place today with the Black Lives Matter movement, I can't fathom that's the best way to handle things is a result of police brutality, is to go to the streets, protest, I understand, but what's going on now is akin to what took place in the 60s when people were burning up their own communities in protest of treatment that was being administered to them by the police department. And as a result of it, you still have some effects of that in places like Detroit, which never really bounced back from the riots. Watts, which maybe you know better than I, never really bounced back from the riots. So, you know, to go to that extreme to get your point across, to me, I just flashed back to that wasn't the best way to handle it, because it affected that community way more than it affected the outcome that they wanted to receive from it. So
outside of the looting, because I think most of the Black Lives Matter the protests are not violent and they're not looting. And we, you know, I think since March or April, in many cities, there have been protests happening every day, you know, in New York and Portland. And, you know, in the heart of it, I think it was happening. They were popping up outside of the United States, even people who kind of identified with that struggle and identified with the injustice, particularly seeing George Floyd being killed on camera. What is your reaction? Like, when you saw, like, if you did see, I don't know if you did, that there were people around the world who took up this thing of Black Lives Matter and felt strongly enough about it to protest in their country, some of which don't really have very many Black people at all, some of which do. What are your thoughts on that?
My thoughts on that is that Black Lives Matters is, and I'll go back to the 60s. What Martin Luther King was doing, to better, number one, the community at large, the United States, make it a better place. And then the other thing that he was doing was trying to pinpoint perspectives that he wanted to see change, equality in education, equality in housing, you know, so he had things that he was pushing for that, yeah, it would make it better for the United States at whole, but he was really focusing on the Black community, making things better for the Black community, which is why the Black community, I felt, got behind it so fervently, rather than the Malcolm X or the you know, the Black Panthers. Well, with Black Lives Matter, to me, I don't see them really doing or promoting things that would be better for the Black community. I don't see defunding the police as being better for the Black community. I don't see taking a stance against the traditional family structure as a betterment for the Black community. I don't see them doing things that would speak in the betterment of education for the Black community. I don't see them speaking in behalf of outrageous numbers of Black males that are being institutionalized in prisons. I don't see them speaking in those behalf. I don't see Black Lives Matters as a Black organization for Black people. I see it as a international organization, which is why there's the international protesting that's taking place. So I don't really see it. I see it as an organization that took an opportunity to use a label, which is Black, to advance their cause, which is not necessarily for the betterment of the Black community at large. So I do see them as an international organization that their goal is power and money. When Black Lives Matter, when the George Floyd situation took place, there was an influx of millions and millions of dollars into the organization Black Lives Matters. But of the money that they've received, I don't know if any of it has been identified to make things better for just Black people.
So let me ask you this. Do you see a reflection between the concerns and the issues that you and your peers had in 71 with some of the issues and concerns that Black people have now? So let's leave Black Lives Matter out of it, but just the actual social justice and racial justice concerns. And so do you see a reflection there? And then I guess as a separate question, how do you see, like, what do you see as the best way forward to address those things, to address racial justice and social justice?
Well, I think from a Black perspective, social justice, I think for the Black community, it starts first with the Black family. The effect of the households of Black families that are without a father or a male influence has such detrimental effects on the community at large, that would be a starting place. Now, you know, that's not a legislative thing that can be done, but I think that one of the higher priorities that I would see. And the second one would be education. I think that it's a absolute disgrace that in Columbus, Ohio, our school system in the Columbus district has been failing for the last at least 10 years, has been incapable of developing a higher grade score, overall grade score, than a D, and cheered when it went to a D. So to me, that's an injustice. That's an absolute injustice right there. You know, to me, those are the two things right there. Those are the things that matter to me. That's what matters for me as far as Black lives. That matters. And then the other thing, the last thing would be the number of Blacks that are being aborted. In New York City right now, more babies are being aborted than there Black babies are being aborted than there are being born. In the era that we were talking about previously to this, in the 1960s, right around that time, the population for the Black community was right around 11% 10-11%. Today it's right around 13%. So over that period of time, our population, as far as the black community is concerned, has only increased by 2 or maybe 3 percentage percent over that period of time. And the reason for that is because of the number of black babies that have been aborted. So without that number, our percentages would be extremely higher than they are now, which not necessarily making that more effective as far as justice and as far as social norms are concerned, but I think that it would have a more positive effect on our community at large than where it is now.
Okay, so thank you, Alan. We're coming up on a couple minutes. We're almost finished, and I wondered if you had a question. I'm sorry, the time has been ticking, but if you had a question for Eddie?
Sure, I'll jump in really quickly. We're at 11:28, so we did really well on time. We got a great recording. Mr. Poindexter, honestly, it was really great to get to meet you and to have this conversation. As I mentioned, I want to talk to you a little bit more in detail later
okay.
at another time, but what I guess I just wanted to follow up. So you shared about, as you scanned across the crowd and you saw the young woman who was a senior and how she was brutalized in that moment. She was struck in the stomach by the police officer, probably repeatedly,
uh-huh.
and then she was arrested by him. And I think that's a powerful moment that will resonate with people who listen to this. And so I wanted to ask kind of a follow-up question in that vein. If there are any more individual, maybe not during the moment when the arrests were made, but any individual particular interactions that were important to you at any point, whether that was between a teacher and another student, or the police and a student, or you and another student, a poignant moment that made you understand things better, or was particularly like unique to this event. Like this, when I think of this event, you know, when I think of the civil rights movement, I think of Malcolm X and certain speeches he made. I think of Dr. King. When you think of this event, are there any incidents that jump out at you?
You know, as far as incidents are concerned, I don't know if there's anything that was probably more prominent than that one. It just seems like that was the one that stood out to me the most, Alan. Everything else was kind of like scattered. It's like, but that one was right in front of me. And things were happening just so rapidly that, you know, it may have been that something else was going on, but I just scanned past that. And I think maybe some of it had to do with the fact that I knew that particular person more so than I knew some of the other people that were involved in some of the other things that were going on. So from that perspective, I don't know if I could really come up with anything else. I've heard things after the fact, but I didn't really see those that had taken place. But for that particular one, it's kind of like Celia was asking me what made me remember this incident so much that it still came to my mind when we were in this class that she was conducting, and that's it. That's the one that the two incidents that stand out the most is her getting beat by the police, and then Donald Vassar raising the flag up on the school. So those are the two things that stood out in my life that if I ever think back on that time, those are the two things that come to mind the quickest.
Well, wow. Very well said, mm-hmm. the way you pulled that together. That's great. That really puts it in perspective.
Okay.
That was really powerful. Can I jump in just one more?
Sure.
Thank you. That's directly related. I really thought it was beautiful, and I didn't want to get paused to make sure we didn't interfere on the tape at all. But I wanted to record it. but you talk so eloquently about that. I wonder if when I first got involved in activism and social justice movements, it was after I had read some things that really impacted me, kind of opened up my mind a bit more. And I wonder if there were any things that were written and shared with students, or something that you read or around that time? Now, I know that you were getting exposed to Black Studies curriculum and all, but just in general, is there anything that you that was written or that you read at that time that really affected you and affected your interest in getting involved?
Yeah, the autobiography of Malcolm X. That was I read that my junior year. It seemed like right around that time. That was an assignment. And that, just hearing his life story, just kind of gave me a perspective of the importance of understanding the culture, understanding how we were where we were at that time, how we got there by his journey in life and his exposure to a different way of thinking than what he had been exposed to growing up as a child. And I think that kind of had an impact on me, that to look at life a little differently, not necessarily from a spokesperson standpoint, but just an awareness, being aware that there's more happening around me than my small world of family, school, and athletics, because that was primarily my world. And so I think that that had a big impact on it. I also read The Invisible Man. And just from a literature standpoint, just from reading that kind of gave me another perspective on how the society at large can see me but not see me, and how to be seen, you know, how to I think probably from that one is when I changed from just going to school to learning at school. Up to that point, I was just going to school, really, just going through the motions. And I was probably a DC student at that point. And it was in my senior year, albeit late, that I started to become a student and raise my grade point up to a CB level. And that's kind of, I think, those two books kind of launched me into wanting to learn more, wanting to understand things at maybe a deeper level than just the surface level of reading a book and living life. So I would say that those two would be the ones that had that type of effect or impact on me.
Great. Oh, wow. Again, that's very powerful.
Absolutely blown away. Thank you, sir. Yeah. That was really
Amen.
Powerful.
Thank you.
Thank you, Eddie, for being here, and thank you for sharing your experiences with us. We really, and I guess we owe you an even greater thank you for kicking this whole project off, because you were the catalyst for this. And
you set the tone. Yeah. Sorry, Celia, I didn't mean to interrupt you, but you're absolutely right.
Yeah, and I'm glad that you were our first interview. I'm really glad.
All right.
Yeah. We